There's a verse in Hebrews 4:16 that says, let us come boldly with confidence before the throne of grace, where we can find mercy and grace to help in our time of need. And that's exactly what we're going to do here today. We're coming before the throne of grace. Amen? So let's lift up the name of Jesus. Here we go. Sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above. I sing for all that you've done for me. Yeah. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Yes, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your I sing for all that you've done for me. We worship your name. Oh, he's worthy, amen. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Oh, and worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear.
Good morning, my name's Tommy. I'm one of the pastors here at Exalt Church. If you are a first-time guest, we are so glad that you are with us this morning. One thing that I absolutely love about this church is the saying that we say around here, don't do life alone. I want to share this story with you. About 2.5 months ago, if you were to go into my hall, we put the kids down for bed, and about 9:30 at night, 10 o'clock, you go out in the hall, every light in the house is on, and their doors are wide open. The power meter is just, boom, spinning out of control. Because of an incident at our house and damage to our house, we had to move Logan into Lily's room. And this is what happened. Lily did not want Logan in her room. Logan did not want to be in Lily's room. But the second night, I walked out into the house at 9:30. The door was closed, all the lights were out, and they were out cold. And it's been like that for 2.5 months. 2 days ago, we got to move Logan back into his room, thank God. And this is what happened, where they didn't want to be together, they didn't want to be next to each other. Lily said, I'm gonna miss him. And Logan said, I don't want to sleep alone. And the first night, Lily was knocking on the door at 10:30. The second night, Logan was in the room with us. And you walk out in the hall and every light in the house is on. Here's the point. When you make a decision to do life together, when you grab a hold of someone else and you say, you know what, I'm gonna do this with you. I'm not gonna do this alone. The darkness goes away. And when you invite Jesus Christ in that equation, the fear is gone. Now here's the fact. Logan had to go back to his room. He didn't have a choice. You don't have to go at it alone. You don't have to walk out these doors and try to do this alone again. Because the second you let go, it goes dark. The fear is back. But we don't do that. We do life together, guys. Let's lift up Jesus Christ. Now, this is going to be super easy. We're going to be rocking this morning. So if you're a new member, just lift up the name of Jesus, church.
Stay. power of our God. And you shine in the shadows, and you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You're an almighty fortress, and you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. And you shine in the shadows, and you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And every fear I lay at your feet, and I sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And every fear I lay at your feet, and I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. No God, the battle belongs to you. Come on, give Jesus praise. Yeah.
Done this one in a while. Let's do this.
Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. And I want more of you, God. And I want more of you, God. And set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. And I want more. And I can't control. I want more of you, God. And I want more of you.
Come on, sing it out.
And set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. And I want more.
Come on, let it be your prayer to sing it out.
More of you, God. I set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. And I want more of you, God. Oh, we want more of you, Lord. I set a fire down in my soul. I want more of you, God. And I want
you to pray that prayer to God. Ask him, Lord, set a fire within me. God, do it. Do your will in me. Let it be done. Don't let me get in the way. Make that your prayer right now. Just pray it out.
Down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. And I want more of you, God. And I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you, God. And I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control.
Thank you. lost inside your perfect light. And I've cried until the healing came. I've run away and back to you. Speak your name. I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid. 'Cause everything gives way when I speak your name. Thank you.
invite you for just a second. This is not planned. I want you to get lost in the thought of who Jesus is for a minute. You got problems. Look at the person beside you. They got problems. I have problems, every single one of them. And so many times it's so easy for us to get caught up in all of the negative, the bad, the everything that's coming against me and everything that's happening. You know what? Jesus is better than all of them. Do you believe that? And I think sometimes we just need to just focus on who He is. Jesus, You are my Prince of Peace. You're my King of Kings. You're my Lord, Lord of my life. I need You, and I don't always let Him have control. Sometimes that's hard, right? But He's always there. And He says, I will never give up on you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Jesus, we focus our attention, our minds, our hearts. Have Your way in us, Jesus. I just want you to take this moment. I want you to talk to Jesus. Talk to Him. Jesus, I need You. I need You to take control of my life. I need You to lead me when I don't know what to do for myself. Lead me, Lord Jesus. I love You, God. We praise Your name. I don't know what's going to happen in the remainder of this service, but I want you to leave your heart open to Him. I know Roger says he's got some things on his heart, and God's going to lead, but invite Jesus. Help me to hear Your voice, Lord. As Roger speaks, help me to hear Your voice, God, that what You want to say to us. Lead us. Guide us. We put our hands, our life in You. We love You. In Jesus' name. Amen. You thankful for Jesus? Give Him praise. Amen. You may be seated.
If you guys could actually take just a moment, say hello to someone you did not come with this morning, give a high five, welcome them into Exalt Church this morning. If you are online, good morning. It is awesome to be with you guys. All right. Well, a warm welcome. Hello from me and from the staff at Exalt Church. We are so glad that you are with us this morning. If you are a first-time guest, whether you're here in the auditorium or you're online, can we get a big round of applause for the online campus? Now, I don't want you to think for a moment that I didn't notice that some people that have been on the online campus are on the actual campus this morning. So good morning, Ms. Corinda. It is great to see you this morning. Mrs. D and Stan Nguyen, it is awesome to have you guys here this morning. It is so good. To Joyce and Gene Webb, hey now, good to see you online. We're glad that you join us up there. Regardless of how or where you meet with us, thank you for being with us. And if you are a first-time guest, if you could go to exaltchurch.com, go to the drop-down tab, click on the Connect card. If you could fill this out just to let us know that you joined us this morning, we want to reach out. We want to welcome you. We want to thank you for trusting us with your time. If you've been coming to Exalt for a while, maybe some of your information has changed. This is the perfect place to update your information, as it's a primary way that we communicate with the church. So please take time, fill out the Connect card today. If you look around, you'll notice we have a family-friendly service. Big round of applause for all Exalt kids. It is so good to see you with us this morning. There's an activity package on the welcome table we would love for your kids to grab. My kids, Logan, Lily, they love filling these out. Make sure you grab one of these. Right now, preschool, nursery birth through preschool is meeting right down the hall. Our Exalt volunteers are ecstatic to talk to your little ones about Jesus Christ as they begin that journey of faith. So we're so thankful that they're with us and they're taking care of the kiddos right now. Let me think. Thinking of kids' church, what What? It's a summer Bible camp, okay? So check it out. Exalt Bible Camp. Absolutely. Woo! This is a return to normalcy. This is something that is going to be amazing through the month of July and August. Bring your preschool through fifth grade. I did not stutter. Through fifth grade. Exalt Kids will be in the nursery, and Exalt Kids will be in Exalt Kids Zone for summer Bible Camp. Please join us for that. They're going to love it. You want to be here for it. While we're learning and hearing about Jesus Christ in here, they're going to be learning and hearing about Jesus Christ in there. Next weekend, now, I know I make you clap a lot. I know I try to get you guys excited. I need y'all to be excited, guys, because next week we are going to celebrate. Graduation celebration is next Sunday at 11 a.m. right here at Exalt Church. And this is for the class of 2021. And 2020, you did not get away. You guys are both welcome here next week as we celebrate your amazing and great accomplishments. And as we thank God for your journey to this point, and we pray over the journey ahead of you guys. Join us next Sunday morning at 11 a.m. for graduation celebration. And with that, did you guys love that last series? Can we get a huge round of applause? For Influence was absolutely amazing. And keep that round of applause going as we welcome Pastor Roger Pate to the stage.
Why don't you guys stand up with me one more time? Amen. I tell you what, the last 2 weeks, the Holy Spirit has just been absolutely phenomenal in this place. Can you agree with that? Amen. Laura and I were on sabbatical for 4 weeks and just had a chance to kind of pray and seek the Lord, and He's just kind of birthing some things in our hearts, and I think He's going to continue that this morning. So let's pray. Father, I thank You for the worship today. I thank You for the gathering of the believers here today, and I thank You in advance for what You are going to do here, even in this service this morning. Lord, I pray You transform lives. I pray that You would impact lives. I pray addictions would be broken. I pray that relationships would be healed. I pray, Lord, that people that have been dry would be renewed in their spirits, Lord. I pray those that have lost passion would receive the passion that they've lost. I pray those that have lost their first love would receive their love again. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen and amen. You can be seated. Look at this, guys, for just a moment. And this is the spiritual life. You come to meet Jesus Christ, and you ask Jesus Christ to come into your life, and He fills you with this presence. You ask the Holy Spirit to come into your life, and he fills you at the very asking. And isn't that wonderful to be filled with the Spirit, to be filled with the love of God, to be filled with the presence of Jesus? It's wonderful. It's great. However, something I know about you, something I know about me, and it's this. Every single one of us leak spiritually. You get filled and you leak. You get filled and you leak. Why is that? Here's why. Because life happens. And when life intersects the spiritual, life oftentimes begins to do something that I like to call punching holes in us. So you're full until life happens. And life begins to punch holes in you. Let's talk about it for a moment. You have the responsibilities of life. You have a job that you're working. You have teenagers that you're raising. You have aging parents that you're taking care of that don't want to be taken care of. And life has a way of just punching holes into you. And then we have this thing called work. Work was around since Adam. In fact, work was supposed to be a spiritual thing, but sin came into the earth and work became evil, because now that was what was supposed to have been easy and enjoyable became labor. And so now the stress of work and the stress of employees and the stress of an employer and the boss's wife punches holes in you. and you stand at the altar and you're naive and you're in love and he can do no wrong and she can say nothing wrong, and you get married and you say, I do, and then the marriage, the wedding ends, and the dress comes off and the tux comes off, and you realize, wow, that dude has some dysfunctions and it puts holes in you. And guess what? That pretty wife sometimes says things that break your heart and hurt your feelings. And it punches holes in you. Life has a way of punching holes in you. Did I mention the spiritual issues that you're fighting against a real devil that's punching holes in you? Have I mentioned to you that you're fighting in a real world that has a culture that's anti-Christian and anti-Bible and anti-God, and you're walking this life and it punches holes in you? You get into a dysfunctional church with a pastor that's not perfect and he punches holes in you? Hello? Thank you for not saying amen to that. 100 brownie points just for that. Amen. And life punches holes with you. And so you lack in your prayer life and you lack in your Bible time. You lack in your church attendance and it punches holes in you. But some of you are doing the Bible time and you're doing the prayer time and you're coming to church and it still punches holes in you. Why? Because you're trying to do it in your own strength and power. And now you're saying, well, I just give up. Because life has a way of just punching holes in to you. Then you have this thing called COVID-19. A pandemic comes along, and whether you lost your job or not, whether you liked wearing a mask or not, you were still frustrated every time you went into Kroger and every time you saw people, and people were more short and people weren't as happy and people were angry and they were rude, and it just punches holes in to you. And then Jesus talks about it. He talks about the cares of life. And the cares of life just punch holes into you. And the deceitfulness of riches punches holes into you. And then there's a thing called sin, and it punches holes into you. And this thing called disobedience to God, and it punches holes into you. And here's what happens. Each one of us becomes simply leaking buckets to where we just leak. All of us are spiritual leakers. I don't know about you, but this last year and a half, I have leaked a whole lot. This last year and a half, I've had holes punched in me over and over and over again until I just leaked and I leaked and I leaked and I leaked and I prayed and I prayed and I prayed until I leaked and I just felt so dry. To where there was nothing else to give. Have you ever been at that point? Mom, dad, have you ever been at that point? Husband, wife, have you ever been at that point? Elder, associate pastor, have you ever been at that point? Christian, have you ever been at that point? Newlywed, have you ever been at that baby Christian, mature Christian point to where you've just leaked? I don't think as I talk to you this morning that I'm the only one that has leaked this year. Because I've looked into your eyes. I've had conversations with you over coffee and at lunch. I've talked to you in the hallways. And I've watched as those masks have covered your nose and your mouth. I can't see the smile or the smirk, but I could look into your eyes and see the shallowness and the tiredness and the wornness and the emptiness. We're leaking buckets every single one of us, because life punches holes in us. Ephesians chapter 5, let's get at it here. Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 18, the Apostle Paul is writing to a church at Ephesus that is in an area where there was all kinds of false God worship, and they would, a part of their worship, they would drink wine and they would get drunk and worship this God. And as they would worship this God, they would lose control with all of these visions from getting drunk, and they would participate in this idolatry. And here's what Paul writes to the church at Ephesus in chapter 5 and verse 18. He says, "And do not get drunk with wine, for that leads to debauchery." In other words, that leads to senseless activities is what that means. But that's not the point of this message. He's not talking about being not drunk with wine. That's just a side note, because he's going somewhere. And so the point is not about the emphatic no, don't do this. The emphasis of this verse is what follows. He says, do not get drunk, because this leads to senseless activities, but be filled. For all my Greek scholars, that's pleroussē. My English is worse than my Greek, actually. Actually, my Greek is worse than my English. Pleroussē. He says, but be filled with the Spirit. He says, don't be drunk with wine, but be filled with the Spirit. Because here's why: life punches holes in you and you leak. Now, I don't know about you, but I was raised in a tradition and was discipled in a tradition that taught it like this. You prayed, you had an experience with the Holy Spirit, you may have been imparted a certain spiritual gift, and you checked the box and you said, it's done. I'm saved, I'm sanctified, I got the Holy Ghost. Don't raise your hands, but some of you were raised in that tradition, that you were saved and God did a work in your life and you had some kind of spiritual ecstasy and maybe you received some spiritual gift and now you're done and you check the box, but something happens. You're still leaking. You're still leaking. That word in the Greek, the pleroussē, what it means is, it means this continuous activity that is not a one and done event. In fact, we could translate it this way. He says, but be continually filled with the fullness of the Holy Spirit. He's not saying come and get one event. He's not saying come and get zapped. He's not saying come and have one thing happen to you. But he says, allow yourself to be continually filled. You don't drink one bottle of water and then quick and say, I've had a glass of water and I'm done for the next 75 years. No, but you continually drink from that water. It's a naive spouse that stands there on the wedding day and gives the vows and thinks that the wedding is the end. So much work is going into planning the wedding, getting the caterer, getting the dress, getting the venue, getting the rings, getting the tux, asking the attendants, getting the invitations out. And they don't realize that at the end of the wedding, now reality begins. And so salvation may have been an event, and you may have had an experience with the Holy Spirit, but that event now gives way to a lifestyle of living that carries on. That baby is born, and you are deceived if you think when that baby is born in the hospital that that's the end, because that baby needs to be fed, and that baby has diapers to be changed, and that baby becomes a teenager one day, and that baby becomes a millennial, and now they're still in your house. Most of you want them there. I know that. You've got good millennials, mom and dad. But here's the point. You know, it doesn't end with the birth. And so mama has worked for hours in labor to give birth to this child. And now life begins. He says, be continually. It is not a one and done thing. It's not I checked that box. Next, listen carefully. It's not as what some of us were taught. A one time, and I want to read this from my notes because I want to say it exactly the way I want to say it. It's not a one time experience resulting in an impartation of a spiritual gift. Instead, it is a continual, ongoing relationship and posture that results in a change of character, that results in a change of priorities, that results in an empowered life that now doesn't live for itself but lives for God's greater purpose. It's a regular pattern of life, of being filled and being refilled, not simply a one-time event and experience. Why? Because life punches holes in you and you leak. And because you leak, you must be refilled. You see, the fact that Paul is speaking about drinking wine right before this verse, he says, don't be drunk with wine, but instead be filled continually with the Spirit in the Greek. What's the point of that? He's making a metaphor. Yes, he is correcting the idolatry of worshiping a false god and getting drunk while worshiping this false god, because when you get drunk, you get loud and you lose control and your ideas and your mind is numbed and all of the things that come with getting drunk, and that's true. But here's what also happens. After you get drunk, you start sobering up and it wears off. And when it wears off, what do you need? You need to get drunk again to get back there again. And in times it wears off. And he says, listen, he says, that's like the Holy Spirit, if I can use that as a metaphor. He's saying, listen, you will be filled with the Spirit, but then you have to go back and be filled again. As you become sober, you come back and you drink from Him again. And here's the metaphor. Here's the contrast. When you're drunk with wine, you lose control because the alcohol controls you. And so because the alcohol controls you, you're out of control. However, when you are filled with the Spirit, something happens. You lose control because the Holy Spirit is in control. Now, what do I mean by that? I don't mean that you get emotionally out of control. I don't mean that we get here and get stupid and get crazy and get kooky and spooky. I'm talking about you lose control, that now you are no longer in the driver's seat or the co-pilot, choosing your own choices, choosing what's righteous, choosing what's not righteous. No, now you're saying the Holy Spirit has filled my life. Refill me. Take control of my life. Because here's what happens, D. As I begin to sober up from the Spirit, I try to grab control of my life and try to set the course of my life. And oftentimes my choices and my course and the way I want to go is not in line with the driver, Holy Spirit. I think you're hearing me this morning, aren't you? And so he says, don't be drunk. But he says, be filled with the Holy Spirit. Not a one and done thing, but a daily thing, a weekly thing, a lifestyle thing. So I want to ask you the question this morning. Are you filled with the Holy Spirit today? Or have you leaked? For about a year and a half, I was just leaking all over the place. Hit a wall situation to where there was absolutely nothing left in me to give. I had absolutely nothing to give. And the sin of that is, oftentimes, if you're a driver and you're a doer and you're an extrovert and you have an outgoing personality, here is what you do. You say, I'm going to rise to the occasion. I'm going to pick myself up by the bootstraps and I'm going to drive myself through it. And where does that get you to where you're absolutely exhausted anymore? Because here is the most difficult thing to say when you are a driver: help. You don't ask a spouse for help. You don't ask a friend for help. And God forbid, you don't even ask God for help. Recently, there was a situation in our household, something very, very minor, something very, very small that we needed favor in with the local authorities. And I told Pastor Dad, my father-in-law, and I said, I am not even going to pray about it because this is a developed world problem and God is dealing with all kinds of problems in India and everywhere else. And the reality is that may sound real humble, but really what that was, it's really a form of spiritual pride because it's saying, God, let me handle the small things and you handle the big things. I got this. I don't need you. And here's the reality. God wants you to want him. God will put you in a place. Amen. God will put you in places where you absolutely have to be dependent upon him, to where the marriage counselor is going to take you so far, but there comes a point you're going to need the infilling of the Holy Spirit to love that guy the way you need to love him. Now, I was raised in a tradition that was very simple. It was let go and let God. All right? I got messed up by the highly educated Presbyterians who didn't even believe there was a Holy Spirit most of the time. All right. I love my Presbyterian friends. I love you guys. Dr. Douglas, appreciate you, man. Amen. But here's the point. I think we've got so educated and so far away in 2021 in our culture that we don't depend on God like we should. We don't ask him to fill us because I'm just going to power through it. And so what happened is the authorities came out and the authorities gave us the answer we wanted and we appreciated it and said, thank you so much. And I told Pastor Dad, my father-in-law, and I said, I didn't pray about it, but praise God, God gave us favor. And the authorities did what we asked them to do. And he says, well, you didn't pray over it, but I did. I said, well, praise God, he heard your prayer. The prayers of a righteous man availeth much. And so here's what happens. We get in this place to where we're going to power through it. Instead of saying, I'm coming to a place to pause and to stop and say, God, as I say today, set a fire in my soul. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. And if we want to get theological and slice that up and get technical and all that stuff and miss this heart of it, you can do that. And that's fine, but I'm not going to do that. I'm simply asking God today on this Sunday as we approach summer, God, I want more of you in my life. I want you to refill me. I'm praying for you in my private prayer time. God, I want Exalt Church to have more of you in their lives. I ask you to fill them and refill them. And as they're punched holes, fill them up again, God, to overflowing. Are you full? Look at Galatians chapter 5 and verse 22, or have you leaked? Here is the evidence of the Spirit-filled life, and let's go through this as a checkbox. I'm not going to get into the Greek language here. I'm just going to stay about 1,000 feet above here. I'm not going to go real high on it, but listen to this. But the fruit of the Spirit, the evidence of the Spirit, the fruit, the production of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. He says, against these there isn't a law. And he says, and those who belong to Christ Jesus, they have crucified the flesh with its passions and its desires. We live by the Spirit. Let's also keep in step with the Spirit. Now, if you go verses before what I just read, Paul lists all of the fruits and the actions of the flesh. And now he contrasts it with the fruit singular of the Spirit. He goes, here is the fruit, not fruits, but in the singular Greek word, here is the fruit. And he's saying, if you are living the Spirit-filled life, you're going to have this fruit. I don't know about you, but over 2019 and into 20, there were times I was not filled overflowing with joy. How about you? Maybe it's just me. There were times standing in line in a cafe, my kindness wasn't there. And can I tell you what got me through sometimes? What got me through sometimes on the road wasn't the Spirit-filled life, but was the fact I had an Exalt Church bumper sticker on my car. You know what I'm saying? I have some creative nicknames for some of the drivers around here. All very Christianized. But kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness. Let me ask you this. Are you gentle? Is self-control a part of your life? Do you have this fruit? Do you have this evidence? I don't care if you spoke in tongues. I want to know if you love. I don't care if you can prophesy. I want to know, is there a kindness that drives you? I don't care that you have the gift to lay hands upon someone in the hospital and heal them. That is wonderful and great, but that is not the fruit of the Spirit. That is a manifestation separate from the fruit. I had one old-time preacher tell me one time, said, Roger, don't be impressed when God uses you to heal someone or to encourage someone. He spoke through a donkey. He can speak through you too and use you. Ouch. What we want is the fruit. And I'm telling you, as you begin to leak the ability to love, to walk in joy, to have peace, to be patient, to be kind, to have this goodness of character and this faithfulness, This gentleness, this self-control as your spirit filled, that fruit just starts happening. It's a result of the Spirit-filled life. But as we leak the fruit isn't there. Love, do you have it? No, not really, Pastor. You've leaked. You need to be refilled with the Holy Spirit today. Joy, do you have it? No, I'm happy sometimes, but I don't have this joy. And joy is not happiness. There's times you're not happy, but there's a joy that takes you through it. Do you have joy? No, I don't have it. You've leaked. Today you need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Self-control, do you have it today? No, I really don't. I've lost all control. I don't have control. I don't have self-discipline. You've leaked. And you need the Holy Spirit to fill you today. And here is how to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And I told the pastoral team this week and leaders and said, I've just been praying all week. I had a whole different sermon I was going to preach today, and I had a whole new sermon series I was going to start and go on, and he just kept bringing it back to here and saying, my people need to be refilled with my Spirit. Have you noticed that the last 2 weeks he's been doing that? Started 2 weeks, we were in worship, and Tony was leading us to a place, and God put that verse from Ezekiel in my heart, and I got up, and it was, hear the words of the Lord, you dry bones, you shall live again. And we sensed a freshness of God's Spirit come over us. And last week, we called you up for prayer, and God ministered to you. I think the last count was, we had five people rededicate their life to the Lord Jesus Christ last week. Amen? Praise God for that. But how to be filled and refilled with the Holy Spirit? I'm going to give you two steps here. Number one, you're going to take away from you today, but I want to address it first. Every day, make the decision to obey God and walk in obedience to God. Every day, make the decision to obey God. Listen. Obey God and leave the consequences to Him. By obeying God, you may not get the promotion. By obeying God, you may lose the job. By obeying God, she may walk away. Are you hearing me? Are you hearing me? The Bible says if you are a believer, and this is not in the notes, but if you're a believer and you're serving God and you're pursuing God and she wants to stay with you, stay with her. But if you're a believer and you're serving God and you're pursuing God, and because of your faith in God, not because you don't close the toilet seat, or because you're a bad driver, or because you forget your anniversary, but if because you're pursuing God and she says, I will not stay with you because you're pursuing God and I want to leave, Paul says, let her go. That's costly. That's hurtful. That's painful. Sleepless nights follows. Pain follows. But so does the filling of the Holy Spirit to empower you again. Hear what I'm saying, not what I'm not saying. I'm not advocating cheap divorce. I'm saying do everything you can to be the godly husband, the godly wife. But I'm here to tell you, do everything you can to be the best employer and the best employee and to rise. But there may come a time in your life that when you say, I serve Jesus, it costs you something. Obey God and leave the consequences to Him. That means you say goodbye to Him because He's married. And you say, I can't date you because you're married. But I love Him. He's married. That means that when you serve God and you love God and you, do I go there? Yes, we go there. And you love God, but He says, I am a Muslim or I'm an unbeliever. You say, I can't be with you. I love you. I care about you. But the Bible says that we cannot be unevenly yoked. That means when your kid comes to you and tells you that there's something that they're not biblical, and they claim that they are something, and they claim that they're a different gender than they were born, you're kind, and you're gracious, and you're loving, but you go to the Scriptures, and you say, I love you, but I can't put my stamp of approval upon something that God says isn't correct. Lovingly. We obey. If you're taking notes, write this down. The most miserable person on the planet isn't an unbeliever. They're happy because they're doing whatever they want to do. The most miserable person on the planet is a disobedient Christian because they know what to do and they're not doing it and they're miserable. When I am disobedient in my faith, I am miserable. I got to hurry up. I'm out of time. Acts 5:32, God freely gives the Holy Spirit to those who hear and obey Him. Luke 9:23 says, if you truly desire to be my disciple, you must disown your life, completely embrace my cross as your own, and surrender my way to my ways. And so here is where it's at. If you want to be filled and refilled, the first place you go is, God, I'm going to obey you. I will go anywhere. I will say anything. I will do anything that you call me to do. And number two, which brings us right here to today that we're going to do today, ask. As you find yourself in this place that you're just leaking because life has punched holes in you, ask Him. Fill me with the Holy Spirit. When you get up in the morning and you turn over and you put your foot on the carpet or the hardwood floors, Father, fill me with your Holy Spirit today. When you're washing your hair, fill me with your Holy Spirit today. I need you. When you're driving down the car and you have your Christian music station on or your country station, God, fill me with your Holy Spirit today. Luke chapter 11, verse 13, Jesus tells this story. He says that even imperfect parents know how to lovingly take care of their children and give them what they need. He says, even an ungodly parent, if the child asks for a fish, doesn't give him a viper. Even an ungodly parent, if the son asks for bread, he doesn't give him a stone. Even an ungodly parent, when he asks for an egg, doesn't give him a scorpion to hurt him and sting him. And he says, if ungodly parents, if imperfect parents know how to give bread and how to give an egg and how to give a fish, he says, how much more will your perfect heavenly Father give you the Spirit's fullness when his children ask him? Amen. So when I ask, Father, fill me with your Spirit, He's not going to give me a demon. He's not going to give me something harmful. He's not going to give me something that's going to hurt and destroy me. Oh, there's sometimes a sanctification where He stretches you and grows you, discipline, but He's not going to give me something bad. Your perfect Father knows what you need. He knows you leak. He knows that this fallen, broken world is punching holes in you emotionally and spiritually and financially and relationally and sexually, just punching holes in you. And he says, he knows that, so ask me. As the band comes quietly to the platform, Acts 7 and verse 7, I'm sorry, Matthew 7 verse 7 puts it this way. Jesus said, ask, and the gift is yours. Seek, and you'll discover. Knock, and the door will be opened for you. Here is what we want to do this morning. We want to give you an opportunity this morning to be refilled. We want to give you an opportunity this morning to come ask God to fill you fresh and anew. And there, I think there's something special and something spectacular when we gather together as believers and we gather together as worshipers and we corporately do this. Amen. You may feel emotional, you may feel nothing. You may feel something, you may feel nothing. But I'm going to tell you, the Bible says, ask, and we will receive. As you stand here this day, do you find yourself where Laura and I were about a month and a half ago? You're just so absolutely empty that you have nothing left. Or maybe you're at that place today, you're at that point where you're like in that halfway mode that you're okay, but you just feel it leaking. We want to pray for you today. We don't want you to walk out of this place without taking a moment. And why are we doing this here in this way this morning? Because here's what I believe. I believe today He'll begin refilling you. And then tomorrow morning you're going to get up and life is going to punch holes in you. And you're going to take your wife by the hand and you're going to say, fill us again, Holy Spirit. You're going to get some bad news. And you're going to sneak off where the kids can't hear you. And you're going to say, God, I don't know what to do. But empower me and fill me with your Spirit. Father, I'm leaking. I've been to the marriage counselor. We tried all the tactics. We have forgiven. We've confessed. We've made promises. And I'm leaking. Fill our marriage with your presence. Lord, I don't know what to do in a church. You lead it through a pandemic. I don't know what to do. I know the programs. I have the church growth methods. I've done it before. But I don't know what to do. So, Lord, would you fill Exalt Church with your presence? You had that fire of God in your life to where nothing else mattered but Jesus, but you just kind of fell off because life has a way of punching holes in you, and now you're going a different direction. And you know you're miserable because you're that disobedient Christian. He says, come home. Come on. Come on. Give your life to me. Pour yourself out. Empty yourself of your dreams and your passions and what you want. Give me your dream. Sometimes the best thing that can happen to you is that the dream you wanted died. For some of you, the best thing that can happen for you is what you wished for and what you desired goes away. Because it brings you to that point that you stand there and you say, God, nothing else matters in my life but you. I'm yours. And until you come, I'm in a broken, fallen world. And until you come and I'm with you in presence and I can touch you and hug you and be with you, I need you every single day to come and pour in me afresh and anew. Because I'm tired. I don't have the answers. I don't know how to do it. I need you. Will you stand to your feet for just a moment and prepare your hearts? I want Tony to sing this song that he hadn't planned on singing this morning, to begin just to sing it quietly for just a moment. Close your eyes for just a moment and listen to these words for a moment. Allow the Holy Spirit to begin to touch your heart today. Church, I want you to come and stand down front. I don't want you to do anything. I want you to come and face the front. Mike, leave your post for a moment. I want you to come and I want you to face the stage. Face the stage. If you have been a past small group leader, I want you to come. I want you to come. If you're a current small group leader, I want you to come. As a mom of three, it wears you out. Tommy, being a business owner, being a dad, being a husband, being an elder, it wears you out. And you have super energy, but you can't do it. You need the Holy Spirit. Amen. Danny, those boys are growing up, but your job isn't done yet because they're going to bring wives and they're going to bring grandkids. You've come and driving up from Elizabeth City every week. You can't do it on your own. Be refilled. Hallelujah. My bride, Laura, I know how many hours you work. I know how much is on you, and you can't do it. You need the Holy Spirit to fill you today. We need His Holy. We can't lead this church in our own power. Our charisma and our strength and our abilities, it breaks down and it fails. We need Him to fill us. We need Him to fill us. If we're going to pass on a legacy, we need Him to fill us. We don't want to pastor a country club. We don't want to pastor a church that's just cool. We want to pastor a church that loves God. We need Him to fill us. That really wants to make an impact. We need Him to fill us today. Stan and Dee, wow, a year. You need Him to fill you today. Thank God for you today. Hallelujah. Chris, I know the battles you have from time to time, and I won't disclose them here. They're all good. But sometimes working for people's hard. Amen. It punches holes. We need to be filled with the Spirit. Father, I ask you, Miss Corinda, wow, you have your iron everywhere. Gifted and talented and have abilities. Getting ready to get married soon. Get a fresh infilling of the Spirit today. Mike, you're on the front lines. Married to a woman and caring people through a pandemic and loving people as they walk in the door with a face mask. And you have grandchildren that don't know the Lord and children that are far from Him. You need His Holy Spirit because you can't reach Him. He has to do it. So we ask. We ask. Father, we ask for our leaders today. You know the needs they have. You know where they're at in life. For mom and dad over here, I ask you, Lord, fill us with your Holy Spirit today. We need more of you in our lives today. Refill us. And all that leaking spots, refill us, Lord. Set us afire again. Not a one and done thing, Lord, but daily. Fill us and refill us and fill us and refill us and fill us again. In Jesus' name, amen. Leaders, take a step forward if you will. We take a step forward. Marge and Chris, take a step forward. Church family, we're not going to get kooky and spooky today. What we just did right here is what we want to do for you. If you're here and you say, Roger, I've been leaking. I just need a fresh infilling and refilling of the Holy Spirit. Step out of your chairs right now and come down front. Please don't wait. Please don't hesitate. Don't hesitate. Come on. Come on. Come on. It's not kooky. It's not spooky. It's not kooky. It's spooky. Let me fill you. Amen. Y'all face this way. Just face this way.
More of you, God. We want more, we want more.
you said that if we ask for an egg, an evil father won't give us a scorpion. You said, Lord, if we ask for bread, an evil father won't give us a stone. Lord, you said if we ask for a fish, an evil father won't give us a snake. But Lord, you are not just a good father. You're certainly not evil. You're not average. You're not good. You are perfection. You are the perfect father. You are the example of what a father is. You are perfection. And so, Lord, we don't ask for fortune today. We don't ask for fame. We're not asking for a job today, all those important. We're not asking God money for our car payment. Oh, that's important. Lord, we're asking for something higher. We're asking for more of you. We're asking for your Holy Spirit to fill and refill us again. Lord, we pour out our sin. We pour out our fears. We pour out our questions. We pour out our control. We pour it out before you. And Lord, we say, our life is yours. We give you our lives. Fill us with your Holy Spirit. Amen. Leaders, will you turn around and I give you freedom just to touch and just pray that God would fill them. God, fill them. Just touch a different person. Don't camp out. Just touch them. Amber, come up here, hon. Amen. So many holes.
I can't contain and I can't control. And I want more of you, God. And I want more of you, God. I set a fire in my soul. Can't contain and I can't control.
Someone to say, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Two things as they slow it down, just quiet for just a moment. Keep playing it quietly, guys, for just a moment. I'm going to let you go in just a moment. Two things. Some of the folks that came up here, you're extroverts. It's easy for you to step out and come forward. Some of you, your wife dragged you. I get it. Some of you, you would have gone up here, but your wife tried to drag you, and you said, no, I'm not going. So my introverts, my shy ones, those of you that have never seen anything like this before, listen to me carefully. The Holy Spirit's right back where you are. Amen. Right where you are. And right where you are, He can fill you where you are. Amen. When you're driving down the car tomorrow and you're just feeling leaked out, you can say, Holy Spirit, fill me afresh and anew. In fact, guys, tomorrow when you leave here, you're going to be leaking on Monday. So practice the sermon. This is not the end. We don't check the box and say, we had a one-time altar call at Exalt Church. Check, I'm filled. No, Holy Spirit, fill me. Holy Spirit, I need you today to empower me. Amen? Will you close your eyes and raise your hands? I want to pray for all of those that are out there. Father, I pray for everyone in this building. If they don't know you, may they come to know you. I ask for every person in this place who isn't a Christ follower, that they would become a Christ follower. Lord, chase them down. Chase them down and chase them down. Love them. God, bring people in their lives that will share the gospel and the good news with them until one day they see the goodness of God and they don't run from you. I pray for that. Lord, now I pray for my believers who, because they're shy or because they're just reserved or, God, they just don't know what Roger's going to do up there today, so I'm staying in my chair. Lord, I pray right where they are, fill them, renew them with your Holy Spirit today. Now listen, I'm going to let you go. There's a verse in the Bible that talks about when David was going to battle and they were pursuing to go take the spoils, and some of the people got so exhausted that they stayed back and only a few of David's men went forward and got the spoils. And they came back and said, we've got the spoils. And they said, we're not going to share it with them because they didn't come forward. Remember that? And David said, no, there's enough. Give it to him. All right? And so that's what I'm saying to you. Guys, there's enough where you're sitting at, where you're at. You don't have to be here. Receive it where you're at. Amen? Amen. Receive His filling right where you are. Amen. Father, as we close out this service, I pray that as life punches holes in us, Lord, that you would refill us. And may we be a testimony to the world of your fruit of love, joy, peace, long-suffering, goodness, oh Lord, that patience and that self-control. Renew your people, I pray today. Refresh your people, I pray today. In Jesus' name, amen. And amen, and amen, amen, amen. Hug somebody, give someone a high five. See you next week, 11 o'clock, right here at the Exalt Church.
So fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control.